Now that I've presented my case against Pelagianism, I want to clarify that us Calvinists are not against good works. I and all Calvinists are well aware that good works are commanded from Scripture for us to do. As just a few examples, Ephesians 2:10, Matthew 5:48, Philippians 4:8, James 2:17, 1 John 2 verses 3 to 6, etc. Each of these commands good works. But the difference is the Calvinist doesn't say that these are foundational to one's salvation. The good works commanded by Scripture are the result of being saved. Good works are a description of a Christian life as opposed to a prescription of salvation. The synergistic model of salvation says that you must continually work to abide in Christ in order to be saved, whereas the Reformed position states that any good works and abiding in Christ is the result of the Holy Spirit working within the person. The synergistic model works to keep the Holy Spirit, whereas the Reformed position states that the Spirit works in you in order that you can have good works. If a person does not have good works, it's evidence that they do not have the Holy Spirit. If a person does have good works, then it's evidence that the Holy Spirit is in them producing those good works. An example of this, and also an example of synergistic error, is found in Philippians chapter 2, verses 12 through 13. Therefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed, so now, not only as in my presence, but much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling, for it is God who works in you both to will and to work for his good pleasure. The pastor in the video that Drop to Zero provided me fixated upon verse 12, where it says, "Work out your salvation with fear and trembling." But in verse 13, it says, "For it is God who works in you to will and to work for his good pleasure." It is only by the work of the Holy Spirit that we abide in Christ, not that the Holy Spirit stays as a result of our work in abiding in Christ. This concept is also found in Galatians, "But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. Now the works of the flesh are evident: sexual immorality, impurity, sensuality, idolatry, sorcery, enmity, strife, jealousy, fits of anger, rivalries, dissensions, divisions, envy, drunkenness, orgies, and things like these. I warn you, as I warned you before, that those who do such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such things there is no law." If a person is unsaved and in the flesh, he will produce the fruit of the flesh, but if a person has the indwelling of the Holy Spirit, he will produce the fruit of the Spirit. The Holy Spirit produces in us what we of ourselves cannot do. Now that I've briefly established the role of works in salvation, I'm going to respond to some things that Drop to Zero said in personal messages. One of the things Drop to Zero said in his messages was that Galatians, if anything, refutes all of Calvinism because it says you are fallen from grace in Galatians chapter 5. He says that this implies that they were once saved and in the grace of God, but they have fallen away from that salvation, thus disproving once saved, always saved, i.e. perseverance of the saints. First of all, I'd like to note that it's ironic that Drop to Zero would appeal to this because the condemnation that they received from Paul was due to the fact that they were relying on themselves for salvation, the very thing that Pelagians do, but I digress. We must ask ourselves if this only merely implies that they were saved or if they were actually saved or not. The phrase "fallen from grace" merely implying that they were saved is not something to create an entire doctrine about. So, how does a silly Calvinist such as myself deal with a phrase such as "fallen from grace"? The first question I would have to ask is, well, what were they fallen from? Let's find an example in Scripture that explains a person falling away from the faith where they were not truly saved in the first place. Let's look at Matthew 13 and the parable of the sower. "Other seeds fell on rocky ground, where they did not have much soil, and immediately they sprang up, since they had no depth of the soil. But when the sun rose, they were scorched, and since they had no root, they withered away. There are those that profess to be in the grace of God, but they have no root. They do not have the Holy Spirit." This now proves that it is possible to fall away without being truly saved beforehand. There are those that make false outward confessions of faith in Christ, but they really don't have the true faith given by the Holy Spirit. It is my argument that they did not fall away from the true grace of God, but rather they fell away from their outward profession of faith in Christ, from their outward profession to be in the grace of God. Furthermore, the beginning of chapter 5 can be seen as a warning to the Galatians for falling into their sin. giving the description of the outcome of what they had done if they persisted in it. And if they did persist in it, then that would be evidence that they are not truly God's children and that they never were. And what was the sin that Paul condemns so blatantly? Them believing that their own works contributed to their salvation as opposed to the grace of God, which is exactly what sinless perfectionists do. Because of my position on Galatians 5:4, that they were not truly saved, and that rather than falling away from true salvation, they fell away from their outward profession of faith that ended up to be false, I'll now try to make a positive case in favor of once saved, always saved, i.e. perseverance of the saints. Because in Drop to Zero's synergistic system of salvation, salvation is a cooperative effort between man and God. It is contingent upon man to continue to produce good works in order to be saved, and therefore salvation is not of the Lord, but rather of God and of man as well. If salvation is conditional upon what you do, then of course there is no eternal security. I'll now give a case for perseverance of the saints, because it is by the will of God that people are saved, and it is contingent upon what God does as opposed to what man does in order to be saved. Perhaps second to John 10, Romans 8 is some of the best evidence in favor of the perseverance of the saints. It says in Romans 8, "Who shall bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies." Again, in verse 35, it says, "Who shall separate us from the love of Christ?" And then the best evidence is verse 38 and 39. "For I am sure that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord." A person's supposed free will would be included in anything else in all creation. Therefore, there is nothing that can separate us from the love of Christ, and there is nothing that can separate us from salvation once regenerated by the Holy Spirit. It is utterly prideful and blasphemous to say that God cannot complete his work that he started in a person. To say that God lifted a person into the heavenly places in Christ, yet that person fell away anyway. Let's look at some more evidence of the perseverance of the saints mentioned in the Bible. In Paul's letter to the Philippians, it starts out in verse 3, "I thank my God in remembrance of you, always in every prayer of mine for you all, making my prayer with joy, because of your partnership in the gospel from the first day until now. And I am sure of this, that he who began a good work in you will bring it to completion at the day of Jesus Christ. It is right for me to feel this way about you all, because I hold you in my heart, for you are all partakers with me of grace, both in my imprisonment and in the defense and confirmation of the gospel." Notice how it says, "he who began a good work in you will bring it to completion at the day of Jesus Christ," not "might or maybe bring it to completion." Yet, I can see within the verse a way of perverting it. A sinner just might say, "Oh, well, it's only saying that the work that God started will be completed when Christ comes back, and then the resurrection happens, and then obviously everything is completed. It doesn't necessarily prove once saved, always saved." In order to disprove that type of view of verse 6, let's look at verse 7. "It is right for me to feel this way about you, because I hold you all in my heart. For you are all partakers with me of grace, both in my imprisonment and in the defense and confirmation of the gospel." Why wouldn't Paul feel right to say this to them?
It's a fact that God completes a work in the sinner when they are glorified in heaven. Paul felt right in saying this to them because he knew that they would persevere to the end and finally be saved, without any opportunity to fall away from the salvation that they once possessed.
And now for the big one. The verse that proves all of Calvinism. The one that we must use in every single situation when dealing with synergists. The single verse that proves over the half of the 5 points of Calvinism. John 6:44. So how does John 6:44 prove the perseverance of the saints? "No one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him, and I will raise him up on the last day." Those that are drawn are those that will be raised up on the last day. Being raised up on the last day is the same as saying that they would be saved, that they will be resurrected on the last day. The only way to deny perseverance of the saints is to deny that the first hymn is the same as the second hymn. Because the two hymns are the same group of people mentioned, the ones drawn are the ones saved. Therefore, perseverance of the saints must be true and is a true doctrine.
So, what are some things that we have learned in this video? The first one is that Calvinists are not against good works and we are not opposed to repentance. Works are not conditional nor foundational to a person's justification, but rather the outcome and the working of the Holy Spirit. The Galatians, who were described as falling away from grace, had fallen away from grace by means of devolving their faith into a moralistic, man-centered, law-centered system of justification, which, as I showed in my first video, is a striking parallel to the sinless perfectionist Pelagian position of drop to zero and those that he follows. As shown in Matthew 13 in the parable of the sower, a person can be described as falling away from the faith or falling away from grace without actually possessing true faith to begin with. The premise of conditional salvation and conditional security is completely undermined by texts such as Romans 8, Philippians 1:6, and John 6:44. There is nothing in all of creation that can separate us from the love of God that's in Christ Jesus.